Hey everybody, it's me, Mrs. Boots, and this is English Language Arts 9B, and today we're talking sonnets. Okay, so this week you had an opportunity to experience poetry that had less structure and more fluidity with both your blackout poetry and in listening to spoken word poetry. Next week, you're going to work with creating your own poetry that actually follows a rigid structure or form. I think I mentioned form in poetry very briefly last week, so I'll talk about that a little bit more here. When we talk about form in poetry, we're talking about the physical structure of a poem. This might include how many lines a poem has, what kind of rhyme scheme or meter it has, and some poetry forms are very simple. A haiku, for example, is a three-line poem where the first and last lines are made up of five syllables and the middle line is made up of seven syllables. A haiku doesn't have to have a specific meter or rhythm. Other forms are a bit longer and have certain purposes. For example, a ballad is the more rigid form that often functions as a storytelling poem. The structure of a ballad is usually composed of four-lined stanzas, which is called a quatrain, with a rhyme scheme of ABCB or sometimes ABAB. The key is that the second and fourth lines rhyme. The first and third lines have four stresses, tetrameter, which is what that is called, while the second and fourth have three stresses, which is called trimeter. And fun fact, the hip-hop classic Rapper's Delight follows this form, and so you could say that Rapper's Delight is somewhat a ballad. And if you don't believe me, let's check it out.
Now what you hear is not a test, I'm rapping to the beat. And me, the groove, and my friends are gonna try to move your feet.
There you go. Four lines alternating with tetrameter and trimeter with the rhyme scheme of ABCB. P.S. If you're interested in the poetics of hip hop, you can check out the book called Book of Rhymes, and our school library has a copy, if like we ever actually get to go back to school one day. And it's a really great book. I highly recommend it. Now, for our class, since we normally be in the middle of Shakespeare right now, we're going to focus on a specific form of poetry often associated with, but certainly not created by Shakespeare, and that is the sonnet. Let's start with what a sonnet is in the first place. So, a sonnet is a 14-line poem written in iambic pentameter, remember that's five da-dums, and contains three quatrains, or three four-line stanzas, and one couplet, which is two lines, with a rhyme scheme of A, B, A, B, C, D, C, D, E, F, G, G. Now, that probably sounds really ridiculous and crazy to you, so let's take a look at a physical example so it'll make a little bit more sense. And we're going to take a look at an example from Romeo and Juliet. So here's the prologue from Romeo and Juliet. And what I'll do is I'll read it first and then I'll point out the features that make it a sonnet or the qualities that make it a sonnet. Two households, both alike in dignity, in fair Verona where we lay our scene. From ancient grudge break to new mutiny, where civil blood makes civil hands unclean. From forth the fatal loins of these two foes, a pair of star-crossed lovers take their life. Whose misadventured, piteous overthrows do with their death bury their parents' strife. The fearful passage of their death mark love, and the continuance of their parents' rage, which but their children's end naught could remove, is now the 2 hours' traffic of our stage. The which, if you with patient ears attend, what here shall miss, our toil shall strive to mend. Now, you might be wondering what this is all about, but essentially what the prologue does here is tell you the entire story of Romeo and Juliet. Shakespeare lays it all out for you right at the beginning of the show. You've got two noble families who live in the city of Verona, which is in Italy, and they hate each other. Think of like the Coopers and the Blossoms if you're fans of Riverdale. Though to be fair, I only watched season one and really couldn't take it anymore. These two families are often fighting and are often the cause of a lot of rumbles in the streets. Romeo is part of one family, and Juliet, of course, is a part of the other family, and they fall in love. And because of their love and things that happen in the play, they end up committing suicide. I'm not giving you a spoiler alert. Shakespeare does this for you. He also tells us things like the play is going to be 2 hours long. So, and I know normally sonnets try to express perhaps like a single purpose, and usually they're used to express love, but here the sonnet is serving the purpose of setting expectations for the audience. So let's take a look at its form, and you'll see that it hits all the check marks for being a sonnet. So it's got 14 lines. Check. Is it in iambic pentameter? Let's check. Let's check one of these lines. In fair Verona where we lay our scene. So it's got that da-dum, 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 da-dum. It's five iambs. That means it's iambic pentameter. Check. Let's look at the rhyme scheme here. I've got dignity. I'm going to mark that with an A. I've got in fair Verona where we lay our scene. I'm going to mark that with B because it doesn't rhyme with the first word there. In the third line, I've got mutiny. Well, that rhymes with the A one, so I'm going to mark that A again. And then the next line ends with unclean, which rhymes with scene. So I'm going to mark that B. So far, so good. We've got A, B, A, B. We have a new sound here in foes. So I'm going to mark that C. And then life would be D. Throws would be C because it rhymes with foes. And strife and life rhyme, so we'll mark that one D again. It's looking pretty clearly like a sonnet, guys. We're going to look at love. Okay, so I'm going to mark that with E. And rage, we'll mark F. Remove, I'll mark with E. It's a little bit off of love. We're going to call it a slant rhyme. Maybe they pronounced it differently in Shakespeare's day. I don't know. And stage, which rhymes with rage, so we're going to mark it F. So we've already got that first part. We've got three quatrains here really nicely. And then we need to end our sonnet with a couplet. And so in this case, it's a rhyming couplet. So the last two lines need to rhyme. So we've got attend and mend. G, G. Perfect. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got ourselves a sonnet. So now you know what a sonnet is. This is your challenge. You're going to exercise your writing skills and create your own sonnets. But you don't have to totally create a new piece of content. We're going to try our hand at sonnet writing by making pop sonnets. And if you're wondering what that is, of course I'm going to explain this to you. Pop sonnets are created when you take a modern song and reimagine it as a Shakespearean sonnet. Let's take a look at an example. Now, maybe you're looking at these lyrics and recognizing them right away, or maybe I'm totally dating myself, but this was a song from a huge show in the 90s that I watched called The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. But every time I teach this lesson, most kids seem to know this song. Just in case, here's the sample.
Now this is a story all about how my life got flipped, turned upside down. And I'd like to take a minute, just sit right there. I'll tell you how I became the prince of a town called Bel-Air.
And the song continues to tell the story of this guy born in West Philadelphia who got in some trouble, had to move in with his rich family in Bel-Air, and hilarity ensues. Let's take a look at the pop sonnet version of this song. Okay, so there it is. From Western Philadelphia I hail, where in my youth I'd play upon the green, till rue the day I found myself assailed by ruffians contemptible and mean. Although the spat was trivial and brief, it wounded my dear mother deep within. And so, to give her conscience sweet relief, she sent me forth to live amongst her kin. When to my port of call I'd been conveyed, I came upon a coachman most unique. And yet I simply took the trip and paid, despite his cad's decor and my fresh mystique. I survey all the land with princely mien in fair Bel-Air, where I do lay my scene. Okay, so aside from hitting all the check marks of a classic sonnet, this still conveys the original content of the source material. I'm going to post several more examples of pop sonnets on the class website today that you can take a look at. You'll be very familiar with a lot of their source material, and there's examples of songs by Eminem, Taylor Swift, and Adele. Give them a read, and I'll also post a link to the pop sonnets website, which has loads more, and they're really fun to want to read. Now, you might be thinking, but I don't talk like Shakespeare. This is crazy. How am I supposed to do this? Well, first of all, how can you learn anything if you don't try out new things? And sometimes learning is hard, but it's an exercise for your brain. And also remember, Shakespeare's English is modern English. It just is a little bit older than what we're used to. And much like Yoda, sometimes he messed up the order of things, but generally you can understand what he's trying to say. And in my next video, I'll introduce you to the world of Shakespeare's English so that you can play around with this and use some of his common phrases and ways of speaking in your pop sonnet. So for now, look at the examples of pop sonnets that I'll post on the class website and on the pop sonnets website, and think about what song you would like to turn into a pop sonnet. And it can be any song, really, even a TV show theme song, just like The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, for example. If it was me and I was a student in my class right now, I'd probably be making a sonnet of the She-Ra theme song, because I am still obsessed with She-Ra. When I like something, I really invest in it. Anyway, once you picked your song, then you can start to think about how you'll turn it into a sonnet form. Next week, you'll have the opportunity to learn more about Shakespeare's English, and you'll have lots of time to craft your pop sonnet. That's it for this video. Remember, if you have any questions, you can always send me an email, ask me a question on Google Classroom, or show up for office hours. I'm always happy to help. Have an awesome day.